Next, we will have a look at the REST architecture. REST means Representational State Transfer Software Architecture. And RESTful indicates typically that a system is conforming to the constraints given by this architecture. What are these constraints? So we're talking about a client-server architecture that is stateless. That means the server does not have to keep any information about the state. It's cacheable. That means you can cache responses for read requests. It's a layered system. That means you can utilize additional software components such as a proxy or load balancer to distribute the load better. And it uses a uniform interface, which is HTTP and TCP protocol. You can also use it for code on demand. That means you can deliver code that is executed on the server. So what advantages does REST get since it uses the HTTP protocol? First of all, the interfaces are very simple. They are portable, that means they are independent of the client and server platform. Everyone knows how to use an HTTP interface. They are cacheable, means you can cache the read requests close to the user, and they are traceable. You can look into the communication and figure out what's going on in this communication protocol using standard tools such as Wireshark. So HTTP has a set of common verbs that you use when you do a request. For example, a GET request retrieves a certain resource, but doesn't do any update. So you basically read data. A PUT request stores some data under a given URL or URI. A POST request transfers some data or entity as a subordinate of the given web resource specified by our URI. You see what that means? And you can delete a given URI, which means to delete an object. So there is the concept of idempotency, which means that when you run an operation multiple times, you get basically the same result. So when I store the same data multiple times, the result is that the data is stored the same. And if I store the same data again under this given URI, well, the data remains the same. Deleting a resource has removed the URI, basically, and deleting it multiple times will lead always to the answer that the data has now been deleted. So GET will also lead to the same result, so when you retrieve some data in a given URI, as long as it hasn't been updated in between for some reasons. So HTTP 1.1 is the Hypertext Transfer Protocol. It's a stateless protocol. So you make a request via TCP, and then you get a response which includes a status and the content via TCP. Both request and response are encoded as ASCII text. And what you get is a header that includes a standardized key value, set of key value pairs. Here you see an example HTTP request. So we use the GET verb, we define a URI here, and we say under which protocol we use it, HTTP 1.1. And we include our key value pairs, which are part of this header. You can also add, so there are standardized key value pairs, but you can also add non-standardized key value pairs. Often they are prefixed with X for extension. There is one data section that is at the end after the request is specified. That includes the request and the response that depends on the media type that is specified. And there is simply a new line between the header and the data that separates those two different types of information. The data section can use any data format pretty much, while our header is always ASCII in this key value notation. So I mentioned media types. What are media types? Well, they are basically an idea to specify what types of data this is that we have included. For Example, you may want to transfer an image in a format PNG, you want to have a text in HTML format. Also for text we have different character sets we can specify. So a media type is composed of a type, here we have image, here text, a subtype and additional optional parameters. The media types, they are registered by the IANA, and here you see an example HTTP request, the response it triggered. So we get here again an answer which says the protocol version, and we get a status code is 200, and we get what it means, it's okay. We get date of the document, get some information about the cache, we get our extensions, here we get cookie information, and finally we had our new line that separates the header from the data. Whatever data is according to the media content. Here the media content type is specified as text HTML in a given character set. So now let's have a closer look at those HTTP words and the typical semantics in regards to directories, which we refer to as a collection in HTTP, and to items, which are basically like files. So the semantics may depend on the service that you have implemented. So, and like I said, on the type, on the URI type, here we have two examples of the URIs. One is here a collection, so basically that ends with a slash. And then we have an item of the collection, which is here like a file, for example. So get basically retrieves the data. In one time, you get a listing about the content of a collection. Pudding allows you to replace a whole collection or to replace an element if you specify just an item. You can post to a directory, which basically means to create a new entry of the collection, and then it will return the URI of this whatever type you have added. You can also post to items, but that's not widely used. So like I said, these are basically the standard semantics, but of course you can implement whatever you want in a service. It's just required for GET and PUT to follow those general semantics. POST is pretty flexible, so you can use that to create various semantics. Okay, delete removes a collection or a specific element. It's really flexible and you can implement everything you like. So how can we use now a RESTful service? Well, we can connect to the IP address of the service and its port and via TCP or manually in a little program that we write, and then you know submit such a little request and waiting for the response in text format. That's possible. We can also use APIs and tools that exist. Curl is a very nice tool, command line tool that allows us to test RESTful APIs. And in Python, we can also write little programs that very easily use those kind of services. So how can we use curl? This now really blends a bit into our exercises that we will be doing. So it's not really about lecturing you, but it's more about the tool. So you can use curl and you can request a certain URL. You can say, I want to send a PUT request. You can encode additional arguments like parameters when calling a specific endpoint. These are separated with the question mark. And different arguments are separated by the ampersand. And you can send here, for example, a specific file and upload it. We can also post a file content to a specific URI or delete it. So all of that is possible. In Python, we can use the request module, for example, compose a header together, where we say we want to submit an application JSON document as a request, and then we submit, for instance, data, which is here a dictionary, and convert it into the data section. So that already mimics pretty much a remote function or a remote method invocation. And then you can, once you have posted the message, you can check out the replies from the server. And if the reply is, for example, JSON, you can load it and process it, for example. Okay. And this is really common. So JSON is also a very common format that is used for Exchange as part of a RESTful API, because it allows you to communicate this kind of semi-structured data. What we will learn next week is that we will look at the Hadoop file system, and the Hadoop file system as part of the Hadoop distributed processing engine and big data solution allows you to access files using the RESTful API. So when you know the host name of the Hadoop file system servers, you can invoke, call it under this directory name. You can access a file name with a certain operation like reading a file or opening a file, and then you get replies, for example, with the data and so forth. And you can get also the metadata. So that means a lot of services that we find in the big data environment that actually offer various APIs, and one typical API that we will find is the RESTful, is a RESTful implementation, which allows us to kind of script and access those systems to our own terms, which makes them quite flexible. So to wrap up, designing a distributed system and algorithm requires us to think about the required functionality, the semantics, which is on one hand the API of the service, but also the inbuilt properties. And we talked about availability, consistency, and fault tolerance. The architectural patterns that we looked at, they provide blueprints for distributed systems. The CAP theorem described us a little bit the limitations of any systems, and particularly limitations that we see in ASIC systems for performance, that then led to the development of NoSQL solutions, because they can be achieve better performance than SQL solutions. So big data systems can use the Lambda architecture, which allows us to load data into a speed layer and into a batch layer, and therewith we can basically get real-time answers while having an optimal processing pipeline that basically combines the answers from a short-term perspective from the speed layer with incremental algorithms, and from accurate answers provided by the batch layer that repeatedly process the whole data and refine the answer. We looked at the REST architecture, and a RESTful system is built on top of HTTP and TCP. It's quite portable and versatile. I wish you a great week and hope you have a look at the exercises.